It is good to see all of you here this morning. It's been a good week for a lot of us. And if you don't have the elements for the Lord's Supper, make sure to get those from the table. We just want to make sure we know about that so we're ready for right after the lesson this morning. And if you're visiting with us, you're invited to sign up online at the visitor card. Very easy to find. I think the first two things, your name and email, those are required. But beyond that, if you want to tell us where you're from, that'd be great as well. And I'd love to hear from you in that way. We're starting today with God's plan for saving us through the gospel, which is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And we want to make sure that we repeat this every week. We don't know if this is our last time together or your last time with us or my last time with us. And we just want to be clear about that in terms of what's necessary. We confess our faith in Jesus as the Son of God, following repentance of sin, and then we call out for salvation in the act of baptism, that immersion in water for the forgiveness of our sins. And this morning we have an example of a brother and sister obeying the gospel at the Honolulu congregation in Honolulu, Hawaii. And by the way, you guys, next time it's Hawaiian Shirt Day, let me know. Several of you, I wanna be in on this. I feel a little bit left out today, but this is a good day for that. But they posted about a week ago and they said, "Welcome your new sister and brother in Christ, Rydenben, 21 years old, and his sister Rachel, 17 years old. Both obeyed the gospel today. Praise the Lord." And so if you have any questions about this, if you wonder why we repeat this every week, pull me aside after worship and we'd love to sit down and study the gospel with you this morning. We understand that we live in a world where nearly everyone around us, really everyone, seems to be a critic of some kind or another. And I know back in the olden days, we would maybe read a review in the newspaper before we went out to dinner somewhere, and we would make the decision as to whether to try out a new restaurant. I love, by the way, that we have a restaurant critic by the name of Dan Curd here in Madison. That is so awesome. Wisconsin's capital city, Dairyland and all that, and Dan Curd is our restaurant critic at the local paper. But today, though, all of us are critics. It's not limited to somebody in the newspaper. Many of us check out the online reviews, don't we, before we go somewhere. We want to know something about what we're getting ourselves into, maybe on Facebook, maybe on Google Maps or Yelp. And not only do we check reviews, sometimes we write reviews ourselves, don't we? We like to chime in. We have our own opinion that we want to get out there and share. I am not sure why. One of my most popular reviews online is of a small restaurant just south of Hurley, Wisconsin, The Bell. And we go there for the green spinach noodles with chicken cutlet. And we found that maybe 15, 20 years ago on a camping trip, and we love going back just for that. That's a highlight of our trip up there now. And every once in a while, as you do as well, if you've done any reviews, I'll get a message from Google, and they'll say, you are valuable. People value your opinion. You know, like you need to make more reviews. They're trying to drum up the flow through their website and all that. You know, people care what you think. 6,000 people, you know, read your review of the chicken at the Bell or whatever. One thing I've noticed through the years is that I tend to have some strong opinions about food, as some of you do as well. And I look back to all my reviews and they focus on food. I love eating when I'm on the road or even here in Madison. I check reviews written by others, but sometimes we chime in with criticism of our own, positive and negative. Sugar River Pizza down in Verona was absolutely amazing. Patsy recommended that. And I think there's one up in Sun Prairie area, but they have one down there as well. That was great. Bill's Barbecue in Henderson, Tennessee. Cottage Cafe down the street here, of course. I've reviewed them a few years back. Congregations appreciate getting reviews. And so if we're on the road somewhere and we have a good, solid experience, I think it's good to share that. And this was a good congregation. Go here if you're in the area kind of thing. Our favorite dog kennel down in McFarland, Wendy Hill Kennel. I noticed there was a review here from 10 or 11 years ago. And try to chime in on those as well. But we share our opinions, don't we? We criticize. And that could be a good criticism. It could be a negative criticism as well. Well, this morning I want to study a passage from the book of Numbers, where we find some incredibly negative comments, a very negative criticism that comes even from within a family. And I want us to come away from this passage with some encouragement concerning how to handle criticism and the negative comments that come from those that we love the most. And this passage is in Numbers chapter 12, and it's really the whole chapter. It's Numbers chapter 12, verses 1 through 16. In our Pew Bibles, this is found on page 237. These are large print editions, so I should say it starts on page 237 and is spread out over a couple pages there. So Numbers chapter 12 is where we are this morning. The context is that God's people have just left Egypt about a year before this. They have received the law on Mount Sinai. Of course, they've crossed the Red Sea already by this point, and they're now 3 days into the next phase of their journey. So this is roughly 1 year after they leave Egypt. So now, though, they're finally actually heading out for the Promised Land. They're making progress in the right direction. Unfortunately, they've already done some complaining on this journey, and they were very, very good about that, you know, in a negative way, of course. In Numbers 11, you may remember they start whining about the food. So we've talked about being a food critic already this morning. They are complaining to Moses and ultimately to God about the food. And they start whining about the lack of meat. Remember they had the manna? They didn't have meat, and so they missed having meat. And it even gets to the point where they wish they could go back to Egypt. Can we even imagine that? They were slaves in Egypt for hundreds of years. And now they're saying, oh, I wish we could go back there. We had such good food back in Egypt. And the first thing they mentioned is cucumbers. And if I were living in slavery for hundreds of years, I don't know if I would miss the cucumbers, first of all. But they missed the cucumbers. And back there we had melons and we had leeks and onions and garlic. But now nothing but manna. And they complain to Moses, even to the point where Moses gets discouraged. He can't handle this. It's like 2 million, 2.5, maybe 3 million people in the wilderness. They're all whining about the food. And Moses takes it to God. He can't handle it anymore. Dear Lord, why have you done this to me? You know, why have you put me in charge of this huge group of people? And in fact, Lord, if this continues, just kill me now. And that's his message to God. It's that bad. Well, in response to that, the Lord has Moses in chapter 11 appoint 70 men to assist in leading the people. So let's spread this out a little bit. That'll give you some support. And then based on the complaint about the lack of meat at the end of chapter 11, God blesses the people with quail. And in fact, he buries them in quail, dead birds 3 feet deep for a day's journey in all directions. So, you want meat? I'll give you meat. And he just buries them in meat. And we can hardly imagine that. Can we picture going out the door this morning and having birds 3 feet deep, you know, for a day's path, you know, in all directions? That is absolutely unreal. But that's how God dealt with that problem. And that leads us to what comes next. As it seems that critical spirit is not just within the congregation of Israel as a whole. It has actually spread into Moses' family, into his inner circle, where his older brother and sister are now joining in on this. So I want us to start our study of this account by going through this chapter chunk by chunk. There are four chunks in this chapter. We'll do this today. We'll just look at the text. Next week, we plan on having a song service. But then 2 weeks from today, I want to go back and then look at some very practical applications of this passage and really make it apply to our lives. But let's start today, though, by looking at the text itself. Before we can apply the Bible, we need to know what it actually says. So we need to go through this a little piece at a time. And I want us to notice the first paragraph comes in verses 1 and 2 where we have the problem. So let's start then by looking at Numbers chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Then Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Cushite woman whom he had married, for he had married a Cushite woman. And they said, "Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us as well?" And the Lord heard it. So this is the problem. The issue here is that Miriam and Aaron speak out against Moses. They complain. They criticize. And remember, Moses has just dealt with the whining of the people in chapter 11, and almost immediately he now hears it from his own family. And isn't that how it happens sometimes? We get beat down in the world all week, and stuff happens, and there are meetings and challenges, and there are behavior issues, and things are going on. And then we come home only to be whacked by those in our own family, by our parents, by our children, or maybe like Moses, by our own brothers and sisters. And I think we agree home is supposed to be a place where we can come and we can relax and we can let our guard down and we don't have to deal with all of the stuff that we have to deal with in the world. But unfortunately, sometimes that is not the case. And we notice a problem here, don't we? There is a complaint in this passage, but then there is the complaint behind the complaint. And I want us to notice how this happens. On the surface, we have Miriam with Aaron as her sidekick complaining to Moses that he had married a Cushite woman. And that description, Cushite woman, is repeated twice in that first paragraph. So Miriam and Aaron were upset that their brother had married a Cushite woman. And it seems as if this criticism is fresh. This doesn't seem like a marriage that happened 40 years ago. This seems to be, there's something happened in the recent past to bring this up. So why are they mad about this now and not 40 years earlier when it seems that Moses first got married? Ultimately, we don't know. We don't have enough information in these two verses to make that determination. We do have several possibilities. First of all, this very well may be a reference to his wife, Zipporah. And I think if you're familiar with Moses, you know he married this woman named Zipporah. Back in Exodus 2, when Moses was around 40 years old, he kills an Egyptian. He flees into the wilderness where he meets the daughters of the priest of Midian. He defends these women from some local shepherds. I didn't go back and read that, but as I remember it, they were hogging the water. They needed water, and they're about to kick them out. And Moses comes along and gets it done, and they're all impressed by his, you know, might or whatever. And so he ends up marrying one of these women, a woman by the name of Zipporah. Moses and Zipporah have two sons together. And then after another 40 years or so, Moses heads back to Egypt to see how things are going. So there's like three phases in Moses' life, up to the age of 40, raised in Egypt in Pharaoh's household. From 40 to 80, he's out in the wilderness. That's when he marries Zipporah, and he's a shepherd for those 40 years. Then at the age of 80, he goes back to Egypt to check in on things. Well, on the way back to Egypt, there is the flinging of the foreskin along the way. Let's say things get a little bit ugly between Moses and his wife on that journey. And it looks like from the text that Zipporah stays behind, that she's like, forget it, I'm going back to my dad. Kind of that seems to be the way that goes down, while Moses continues on to Egypt and then meets up with Aaron and Miriam. So here we are a number of years later, and now everybody's headed for the promised land. And some people have suggested that Miriam and Aaron are upset that Moses has married Zipporah, that she is the Cushite woman. And this is fresh because although Moses has been married for many years, Miriam and Aaron are just meeting this woman for the first time. You know, she's been in Midian with Moses. Now Moses comes back where Miriam and Aaron are, and now they're just meeting this woman. And so in the process, they described her as a Cushite woman. Well, the problem is Cush is a land south of Egypt, basically modern-day Ethiopia. And we know that Moses actually meets Zipporah in Midian, which is not south of Egypt. So this is where we have the problem. How is Zipporah, if this is Zipporah, how is she described as a Cushite woman if she's not actually from Cush? So there's where people say, okay, what in the world is going on here? One way around this is that Cushite is something of a racial slur. And a lot of the commentaries go in this direction. So the idea is they're not really describing where this woman is from, but they are cutting on her as a foreigner. And they're using this as a description in that way. And that term does seem to be used perhaps in that way in Habakkuk 3, verse 7. And so the first possibility is that Zipporah is the Cushite woman, but it's a racial slur. It's a comment describing perhaps how she looks. Not necessarily where she is actually from. The second possibility is that Zipporah has died and that Moses has remarried a woman who is actually from the land of Cush. After all, Moses is at least 81 years old at this point, and it is possible that he has outlived at least a wife or two. if that makes sense. And so maybe there is a new woman who is from Cush. A third possibility is that Jethro, the priest of Midian, was originally from Cush or Ethiopia, and that he traveled up to Midian, making Zipporah a Cushite by birth. That's one possibility. And then the fourth possibility is that Moses has married a Cushite woman in addition to Zipporah, that he now has two wives. But I would just point out the issue in this passage isn't that he's taken another wife. The issue is that this woman is a Cushite. So these are some possibilities, just saying that there is a difficulty in understanding this passage, but these are some of the possibilities. Ultimately, we don't really know for sure who this woman is. However, I hope we notice that Moses' choice of a wife is not the real issue in this passage. Some commentaries have referred to this first complaint as something of a smokescreen. And I think we look at these verses, we understand what they're saying there. I think as with a lot of complaining, the issue is not always the issue. They start with this complaint about this Cushite woman, but notice they immediately say, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us as well? So as I look for a transition between verses 1 and 2, there is no transition, is there? To me, I'm like, what in the world is going on there? There is no connection between these two, at least with me. And I guess we could say sometimes our whining doesn't make sense, does it? Sometimes we complain about something that's really not the issue. It's really based on something else. That's a possibility there. But maybe there is a connection. Maybe Moses' wife was seen as a threat to Miriam and Aaron. Who is this strange foreign woman who's advising our younger brother? Who knows? But ultimately, they finally get to the real issue, which is that Miriam and Aaron, they seem to be envious of their brother's position and his authority. Who does he think he is to think that he has this hotline to God in some way that we don't? And another note here, don't we see something slightly similar in the life of Jesus? Remember the time when his own brothers thought that he'd lost his mind and they tried to take him away by force? Our brother's lost it here. We need to go put him somewhere. He's not well. What happens here in Numbers 12, it's also very similar to Jesus being rejected in Nazareth. The Bible says they took offense at him, according to Matthew 13:57. But Jesus said, a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and in his own household. So Jesus is basically saying, I'm respected everywhere I go except for Nazareth. And that almost seems to be what's happening to Moses in this issue. This is what he's facing. And when we think about it, this is where we realize Miriam and Aaron are not really accusing Moses of personally doing anything wrong. I kept reading through this, and I don't know if we noticed that in this passage. Who are they actually accusing in this passage? With the actual words that they speak, aren't they accusing God here? The issue is really with God. Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us as well? That's not Moses' fault. Moses tried to get out of this. Remember that? God's like, I need you to go and do this thing. And Moses, please, no, Lord, I don't want to. And so he's not the one out there grabbing power and claiming this stuff for himself. But this is God's fault, according to Miriam and Aaron. So they seem then to be motivated by envy, even though both of them certainly have some clout on their own. If you remember, Aaron is the high priest. Is that an important position? He's leading 2.5-3 million people plus. He's the only guy who can go into the most holy place. That is a seriously heavy position for him to have. Miriam herself is described as a prophetess in Exodus 15, verse 20, taking a leading role in worship among the women of Israel. And so in reality, the answer to their second question up here really is yes. Has he not spoken through us as well? Yes, he has spoken through us as well. But they're envious. And I would also note Moses is their younger brother. I wonder if that figures in here. Sometimes we forget that they are older than he was. And remember, Miriam rescued him from the crocodile-infested Nile River and arranged for his care in Pharaoh's household. So certainly Moses owes his life to his big sister. Aaron was Moses' spokesperson, taking a leading role publicly. But Miriam and Aaron, though, they are clearly not content. They've got their own work to do as prophetess and priest in Israel, but they're looking over at their brother, and whatever they're doing is not enough, and they're mad about that. They're envious, and they resent their brother's relationship with God. And really, they seem to be in the process of rejecting his leadership. Just like the nation rejecting Samuel in favor of a king, and like the scribes and Pharisees rejecting Jesus as their king, Miriam and Aaron are challenging Moses, but they're not really challenging Moses. They're actually challenging God himself. I would also emphasize that Miriam seems to lead in this attack, and that's kind of easy for us to miss, but notice her name is listed first in this passage. And that's a little bit unusual in Bible times for the woman's name to come first. And I believe the verb to speak against, as I understand it in verse 1, is feminine. And so there's Miriam and Aaron, and she speaks against. And so the emphasis here is on Miriam, and Aaron is simply along for the ride. He's simply there with his sister saying amen to whatever she says. And it almost reminds me of Adam and Eve in the garden. Isn't that how that went down? You know, Eve took the leading role in eating the fruit. She gave it to her husband, and he kind of followed along. And that's the picture that I get from verses 1 and 2 of this chapter. Before we move on from the problem in this first paragraph, let's just note here at the end that God sees the problem, doesn't he? He cuts right through this. He sees what's happening. And the Lord heard it. And my understanding is that this is only two words in the Hebrew language, Yahweh heard. So we have this description, Yahweh heard. And in a way, that's rather terrifying. Miriam and Aaron complain to their brother, apparently in private, and God hears it. Yahweh hears. We think about what the Lord Jesus says later in Matthew 12, 36 and 37. But I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give an accounting for it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. We see that right here in this passage. In doing the research for today's lesson, I came across a good reminder from another preacher. He said, no matter how much you lower your voice when you speak against someone, God hears. God knows what is prompting you to say it, and God is himself wounded over the diminishment of one created in his image. And I thought that was a good reminder. So this is the problem. Miriam and Aaron are unjustly criticizing their younger brother. They start with what seems to be fake outrage over his Cushite wife, which is really just a cover for expressing their envy over Moses' authority, which was given to him by God. So as we go back to the text, let's continue with God's defense of Moses. And we see this in Numbers 12, verses 3 through 9. Numbers 12, 3 through 9. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than any man who was on the face of the earth. Suddenly the Lord said to Moses and Aaron and to Miriam, you three come out to the tent of meeting. So the three of them came out. Then the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood at the doorway of the tent, and he called Aaron and Miriam. When they had both come forward, he said, hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, shall make myself known to him in a vision. I shall speak with him in a dream. Not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my household. With him I speak mouth to mouth, even openly and not in dark sayings, and he beholds the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant, against Moses? So the anger of the Lord burned against them, and he departed. Well, Moses then is basically accused of arrogantly speaking on God's behalf. And then we have this little parenthetical statement in verse 3. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than any man who was on the face of the earth. If you remember, the book of Numbers was written by Moses. Several weeks ago, I mentioned that if you ever get a humility award, and if you ever hang it on your wall, that's the moment they take it away. Remember that? And so I think of that when I read this passage. And so the way I see this, Moses doesn't necessarily write these words. It's hard to justify the most humble man on the face of the earth bragging about it. But this statement of verse 3 is most likely added by whoever compiles Moses' writings after he dies. And I would say it's similar to the passage about Moses' death at the end of the book of Deuteronomy. Like writing about your own death and burial, it's a bit difficult to describe yourself as being the most humble man on the face of the earth. It is a true statement. It's inspired. This is from God. But there's a good chance that Moses didn't actually pen that. Nevertheless, in terms of God's response, it starts with this reminder. Moses is not the problem here. Moses is not the issue. In fact, I noted here, God responds suddenly at the end of verse 4. That caught my mind. You know, a lot of times God delays judgment or response to some of these things, but this made God mad. And God responds suddenly, immediately summoning Moses, Aaron, and Miriam to the tent of meeting. And in my mind, this is a little bit like being called into the principal's office. You know, come to my office at this time of day or whatever. God comes down in this pillar of cloud. And then with these three there at the door of the tent of meeting, notice he calls Aaron and Miriam. Moses is left to the side there, kind of off to the side. So up to this point, Aaron and Miriam might have been thinking, yeah, Moses is going to get it. You know, God's going to finally, you know, nail him for being as arrogant as he is and all that kind of thing. That does not seem to be the way this is going. Some of the ancient Jewish rabbis suggested that Moses is left out of this final phase of the meeting because God didn't want Moses to hear what he's about to say. It's kind of like the idea God didn't want Moses to get the big head. Like, well, I'm going to leave him out for the praise part of this. I just thought that was interesting theory from the past. But the problem, though, is very clearly with Aaron and Miriam. Moses is not the issue. And so God goes on to give this poem. It's almost a song. There is an arrangement. There is a structure to it. A lot of your translations may set this aside as verse. And it was in mine, too, but I kind of squished it all together just for the sake of the space that we don't have up here. But it's arranged in an interesting way, and God goes on to praise Moses. Normally, God says he speaks to prophets in visions and dreams using these dark and mysterious sayings. But notice with Moses, though, God speaks openly, mouth to mouth, almost like face to face, we might say. Over in Exodus 33:20, God says, "You cannot see my face, for no man can see me and live." So I would just take this mouth to mouth as a figure of speech. And God can do this. He can speak to Moses in this way, he says, because Moses is faithful in all my household, in verse 7. So God can trust Moses. God and Moses have an understanding between them. And I think of the trust between Potiphar and Joseph. Remember, Potiphar could trust Joseph with everything. He's in charge. He's my manager. I ask no questions. He does a great job, similar to the trust between Abraham and his servant Eleazar. As we think about God's response, what is truly ironic is that when Miriam and Aaron complain that God is only speaking to Moses, God immediately comes down and only speaks to Miriam and Aaron while excluding Moses. Of course, this is not the kind of attention that they were looking for. That's not the kind of communication they were hoping for. But God, though, does speak to them, doesn't he? "Now hear my words," God says. "Moses is faithful in all my household." And twice in this passage, Moses is referred to by God as my servant. He's not Miriam and Aaron's servant. He is my servant, God says. And basically, as I understand this paragraph, God is saying, "I am communicating with your brother Moses in a way that the two of you cannot comprehend. My relationship with Moses is so far beyond any other human person." And so at the last part of verse 8, God is basically saying, "How dare you? How dare you do this? If it weren't for Moses, you two would be nobodies." Or as he actually says, "Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant, against Moses? How dare you lecture Almighty God as to who he communicates with and how he does things or how the king runs his kingdom?" And so in verse 9, the anger of the Lord burns against them. God is mad at this point. So this brings us to Miriam's punishment. And this is in verses 10, 11, and 12. So chapter 12 of Numbers, verses 10 through 12. "But when the cloud had withdrawn from over the tent, behold, Miriam was leprous, as white as snow. As Aaron turned toward Miriam, behold, she was leprous. Then Aaron said to Moses, O my Lord, I beg you, do not account this sin to us, in which we have acted foolishly and in which we have sinned. Oh, do not let her be like one dead, whose flesh is half eaten away when he comes from his mother's womb. We have several things going on here, starting with the fact Aaron seems to notice that Miriam is covered with leprosy even before she notices that she's covered with leprosy. And that's fascinating to me. I'm thinking, if I'm covered in leprosy, I'm looking out, I don't see it. But if my friend looks at me and says, whoa, you know, there's something terrible wrong, that seems to be what Aaron does here. And I don't know whether we've all thought about this, but one job that was given to the priests was inspecting skin conditions. You remember that? That was their deal. That's what they did. In some ways, they were almost like the Department of Public Health. If somebody had some issue, you had to take it to a priest, and they were the experts, and they could look and they could say, ooh, that's bad, or no, you're going to be okay, this is what you need to do about it. And they had to take it to the priest. So I would just point out here, Aaron is now doing his job, isn't he? Aaron is back in his lane. He's now doing what God had originally called him to do. And perhaps it is also somewhat ironic that by choosing leprosy as a punishment, remember, he could have burned him with fire, lightning bolt, swallowed by the earth. God has options when it comes to doing things to people. I find it interesting that God turns this woman white. Remember, one possibility we discussed earlier is that Miriam is upset that Moses' wife is from Ethiopia, and that by referring to her as the Cushite woman, she was actually using a slur, that she was commenting on her appearance. In other words, this woman is obviously, by looking at her, not one of us. And so if that is the motivation here, I do find it interesting that God chooses leprosy as the punishment. It's almost as if God hears her complaint and then says, if you're making judgments based on skin color, let's make your skin as white as snow for a little while, and let's see how that works out for you. And let's not forget, in those days, being diagnosed with leprosy was pretty much a death sentence, wasn't it? There was no cure. It was awful. You had to leave the camp and not come back until you were clean and cleared by a priest, which, as I understand it, was incredibly rare. People did not get over this. The social stigma was intense. If you remember from the Law of Moses, those with leprosy had to cover their mustaches with their hand. They had to cover their upper lip when they were traveling out in public, and they had to cry out loud, unclean, unclean. That was the law. That's what they had to do. Today, do we know of people who have to cover their faces because of an infectious disease? Like, we know something about what's going on there, and I might compare this to being COVID positive, but permanently. That's, you know, it was like this terrible thing, and there was some stigma to it. Many of you have had to quarantine in your own homes over the past couple years. I nearly lost my mind, cut off from the world for 5 days back in April. And I know I had 5 days. Some of you, a year or two ago, it was like 2 weeks, wasn't it? It was a lot more, so they've cut it down. But man, 5 days was tough. I wiped out Netflix and Amazon Prime Video. I think I watched it all. And I had to resort to the free section on Roku, where I watched like 5 or 6 seasons of This Old House. And that's what I did for like 5 days straight. And it was awful. But Miriam, though, she would have been banished. Leave. You just leave our camp. You are not welcome here, only to die a slow and agonizing death. So as God leaves this scene, we have Miriam covered in leprosy. We've got Aaron making the diagnosis, apparently even before Miriam realizes what's going on. And now we have Aaron begging Moses to intercede. So we have Aaron acknowledging that a sin has taken place here. At this point, notice in verse 11, we have Aaron begging for forgiveness. And notice he's asking for forgiveness for us in this incident, in which we have acted foolishly and in which we have sinned. So Miriam is hit with the leprosy. As we discussed earlier, she's the one who takes the lead. She's the one who speaks here. But Aaron knows that he's guilty as well. And I see that admission in these verses. He's definitely in on it, and he knows it. Aaron was there for support. And as an accomplice, I would emphasize Aaron is therefore unable to take care of this on his own. He's now disqualified as a priest from going to God and asking for forgiveness. He's unclean. He's on the outside here. And so Aaron then is forced to ask his brother, younger brother Moses, for help. I would also notice how Aaron emphasizes they have acted foolishly. Remember, under the law, intentional sin was punishable by death. If you sinned unintentionally, if it was just foolish, I got caught up in the moment, it was an accident, well, God handled that differently. And I would just say Aaron is pointing out this was unintentional. This was a foolish, I was caught up, you didn't know what we were doing. I think of our kids when they did something wrong when they were 4 or 5 years old. The first thing was, it was an accident. And, you know, because there's a difference between if you did it accidentally or if you did it intentionally. And so I think Aaron is making that claim here. We were foolish in doing this. But we have God's punishment, and Aaron begs his younger brother Moses for mercy. And he finally understands that Moses has a pretty important role in the nation, and he's forced to admit this. And this leads us to the last paragraph. This is where Moses now intercedes. And we pick up with the last few verses, Numbers 12, 13 through 16. Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, O God, heal her, I pray. But the Lord said to Moses, if her father had but spit in her face, would she not bear her shame for 7 days? Let her be shut up for 7 days outside the camp, and afterwards she may be received again. So Miriam was shut up outside the camp for 7 days, and the people did not move on until Miriam was received again. Afterward, however, the people moved out from Hazeroth and camped in the wilderness of Paran. Moses intercedes then. Since Aaron is guilty of sin himself, Moses steps in, O God, heal her, I pray. And I don't know whether we've realized this, but these are Moses' first words in this chapter. If you look for, like if the words of Moses were in red, this is the first thing that he says here. And we'll have more on this in a couple weeks, but just for now, Moses intercedes. He begs God for mercy on behalf of his older sister. There is some back and forth here. God basically makes the point that she really needs to feel this for a while. This is not, oh, never mind, you're okay. But she needs to feel the weight of what she's done. And God determines 7 days will do that. She needs to bear her shame. And so for 7 days, she's shut up outside the camp. And the whole nation pauses for 7 days. They stop progress on this journey, all 2 to 3 million of them, until Miriam is cleared for travel. So instead of a lifetime of leprosy, instead of a lifetime of loneliness, God intervenes and shows mercy, all because Moses speaks up here. So sin can be forgiven. And that seems to be one lesson we can get out of this in practical terms, even before we come back to it in a couple weeks. But sin may have consequences, but sin can be forgiven. Well, how do we know Miriam is forgiven? Well, first of all, she survives this incident. Secondly, Miriam is honored after a while with a positive reference to her death many years later. And that is rare among women in the Old Testament. It does happen from time to time, but it's usually that mention reserved for great people, great leaders. And she does get that mention when she ultimately dies. But then also we have an interesting reference hundreds of years later where God is pleading with his people, begging them to repent before it's too late. And as he summarizes everything he's done for them, this is what he says in Micah 6, verse 4. Indeed, I brought you up from the land of Egypt and ransomed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses and Aaron and Miriam. Miriam then is listed as a leader of Israel, right alongside of Moses and Aaron, even though God very easily could have just erased her from the biblical record, but he didn't. So Moses and Aaron and Miriam, they were not perfect by any means. All three had their issues, but they certainly allowed themselves to be used by God for great good. And that brings us to the end of our study today with a reminder that even when we sin, if we criticize, if we're the ones guilty of offering the unjust criticism, forgiveness is available if we repent, if we turn away from it, if we acknowledge it, and if we ask God for forgiveness. Some have suggested that the nation showed grace by sticking around, and I thought that was interesting. Some of the commentaries were saying, oh, how nice of the people of Israel to wait those 7 days instead of leaving her behind in the wilderness. But is that the case? Do you remember why the people moved from place to place? Weren't they following the pillar of cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night? It wasn't the people who waited for Miriam. It was God who said, we're not moving Nobody's left behind. We're moving forward together, and that's going to include Miriam. So let's leave it here for today. Next week, we sing together, and the week after that, let's look at some very practical lessons from this passage. Before we prepare for the Lord's Supper, let's close this part by going to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, you have revealed yourself to us this morning as a God who does not tolerate unjust criticism motivated by envy. And yet you've also revealed yourself as a God of mercy and grace. Thank you, Father, for being so patient with us. Thank you for sparing us when we sin. Thank you for making us a part of your kingdom, the church. As a part of this congregation, we pray that we would lean on each other for support. We pray that when we're tempted, we would reach out for help. And we pray for wisdom as we encourage and as we hold each other accountable. Father, you are worthy of all praise. You have redeemed us, people from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. As your priest, we pray for your help as we struggle against sin. We come to you today in the name of your Son, Jesus, our King. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. So as Moses was the intercessor for Miriam and Aaron, so too is Jesus our intercessor in his sacrifice and being here. So when I was picking out these songs, I was thinking about Jesus as our intercessor. So that was kind of the reasoning behind the songs this morning. So first song will be 805 in the book. 805, I Come to the Garden Alone. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God is close, and he walks with me, and he talks with me.
As we gather on the first day of the week, we partake of this memorial to Christ's death on the cross to keep it fresh in our minds, to help us remember that our sins were bought and paid for with a supreme price. So as we partake of this, let's remember that sacrifice and let's endeavor to be better sacrifices ourselves as we go through the week. Let's go to God in prayer. Our righteous and loving Father in heaven, we thank you so much that your love was manifested for us by the giving of your Son, that he walked on this earth, that he taught us, and that he taught us what perfect obedience was. We're so thankful that he gave his life on the cross for our sins. We pray, Father, that we will always respect that and never take that for granted, that we will always seek out to do thy will, that we will be obedient to your will, that we'll be baptized into Christ's blood for the forgiveness of our sins. Father, as we think about this sacrifice, help us to live our lives in such a way this week that we can be living sacrifices to you. We thank you for this bread, and it reminds us, Father, of his body that was nailed there on the cross for us. Help us to partake in a manner that's pleasing to you. It's in his precious name we pray. Amen. Let's continue our prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this fruit of the vine. It reminds us of Christ's blood that was poured out upon that cross as the only lasting and perfect purchase price for our sins. Help us to remember, Father, the sacrifice, and help us to be a sacrifice for you. It's in his precious name we pray. Amen. All right, let's continue our worship.
As we continue in worship, our next song will be number 179 in the book. Number 179. God is calling the prodigal, come without delay. Hear, O hear him calling, calling now for thee. Though you've wandered so far from his presence, come today. Hear his loving voice calling still, calling now for thee. Oh, come, calling now for Amen. Our next song is number 438. Number 438. My hope is built on nothing less. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. All right, number 294 will be our next song. Number 294. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear. Jesus, I must For our final song, we will sing number 841. Number 841. This is a song I always come back to because just with God and Jesus, there's always time to be happy. If the skies above you are gray, you are feeling so blue, there is still time to sing and be happy. Often we fail to see the rainbow up in heaven's fair sky. There is always time to be happy, whether the skies are gray, whether the skies are clear. There is always joy to be found. So as we sing this closing song and have our closing prayer, let's also stand and sing, if you're willing and able. Number 841, sing and be happy. Ladies, let us hear on the chorus. If the skies above you are gray, you are feeling so blue. If your cares and burdens seem great all the whole day through, there's a silver lining that in my friend, trust in his promises grand. Sing and you'll be happy today. Press along to the goal. Trust in him who leadeth the way. He is keeping your soul. Let the world know where you belong. Look to Jesus and pray. Lift your voice and praise him in song. Sing and be happy today. Often we troubled and tired, sick with sorrow and pain. There are others living in sin, blessed with earthly gain. Take new courage, we cannot tell what tomorrow may bring. When the dark clouds vanish away, then your heart truly can sing. You gotta sing and you'll be happy today. Press along to the goal.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity for us to come together to worship you, sing your praises, learn from your lessons, and just be happy and praise God. Help us to be mindful of what we've learned, what we know as we go out in the world, helping us to be better Christians, better examples, and stewards. Help us to be mindful of everything around us and appreciate all your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.